Good afternoon, everyone. I am Professor Antoine Vieillard-Baron from Paris, and I have to give you a lecture about the echocardiographic patterns in COVID-19 patients. So I do not have any conflict of interest. Just very briefly to look at the challenge we have to deal in last March, you have here the peak of admission in the ICUs in the Great Paris, and especially in the APHP hospital. You can see how many patients we have to manage in a very short period of time. So first, why performing a critical care echocardiography in COVID-19 patients? First of all, of course, because we know that now many patients develop shock, and look at, for instance, this large series of a patient admitted in four ICUs in the Great Paris. And you can see that a little bit than half of them required a vasopressor infusion. If you look at the other series, and you can see there is some heterogeneity, but you can see that overall, more than 60% of patients admitted for COVID-19 in the ICU required a vasopressor infusion. This study also is very interesting. It's not really a study. This is a survey, but international survey. Worldwide, you can see more than 1,000 responses to the survey, and you can see that intensivists declare in more than 50% of cases that they have to use very frequently in strong RAID or frequently in light RAID vasopressors in their patients. And you can see that very interesting that they also declared that most of them, they use echocardiography just to evaluate the cardiac function in these patients requiring vasopressor infusion. If you look at, once again, the echo in the hemodynamic management in COVID-19, you can see number one for cardiac output measurement and fluid responsiveness assessment in Europe, number one in South America, and number one in North America. So clearly, echo device is very suitable in this pandemic to evaluate the hemodynamics in these patients. And very briefly, and I will speak about that later, you can see in this survey that a little bit more than 50% of patients, actually they had a normal echocardiography, but you can see that many of them also had a significant cardiac injury. The second argument, of course, is that we know that echo may save lives, even though we do not have a big trial just to be sure of that. It's not very specific of COVID-19 patients. Here, this is a study performed in septic patients. You can see using the MIMIC-3 database, and you can see that especially in patients ventilated and requiring vasopressor, echocardiography use was associated independently with increased survival in these patients. The third argument, of course, for doing an echo in COVID-19 patients is that we know that many patients develop pulmonary embolism or at least some thrombosis into the pulmonary circulation. And so in this situation, we know that echo is very suitable as it may evaluate the RV function and may give you some echo suspicion or sometime echo diagnosis of this complication by visualizing some clot into the right heart or into the pulmonary artery, especially if you perform TEE. And if you look at the incidence of this kind of complication in COVID-19 patients in this large series, in patients who systematically had a CTPA, you can see that 22% of them actually had some clot into the pulmonary circulation, most of them in the segmental arteries, but you can see in some of them in the lobar or even central pulmonary arteries. So we have some preliminary data regarding the echo patterns in COVID-19 patients. The first data we have, first paper, I think, published in the field, is a very small series of patients, but especially interesting because the authors compare the echo patterns in COVID-19 patients ventilated for ARDS compared to flu patients. And you can see the first and the main interesting information is that in the COVID-19 patients, patients develop less acute corpulmonale compared to patients ventilated for flu. And this is probably especially true because we know that the compliance of the respiratory system and of the lung is probably less depressed in COVID-19 patients compared to flu or usual ARDS. We have this recent paper performed in 100 patients admitted in the hospital for COVID-19. You can see that only some of them, 39, had moderate to severe injury, so probably admitted, but we do not have the information in the ICU. And you can see that in all of these patients, they perform an echo at the admission. You can see that the echo was normal in 1/3 of patients. And you can see that only observed a few number of patients with left ventricular systolic dysfunction. And this is probably explained by the fact that most of these patients were not admitted in the ICU. And the major picture, the major pattern was right ventricular dilatation and dysfunction in 40% of patients. And you can see something interesting in this study is that globally in all patients, the mean pulmonary artery acceleration time was below 100 millimeters of milliseconds. You can see this parameter is the time between the beginning of the RV ejection to the peak of the ejection. And this is usually used as a surrogate of pulmonary hypertension. So there's just suggested that most of these patients actually had pulmonary hypertension. In my unit, because we use for a long time critical care echocardiography in our patients, we did a serial echo in our patient admitted in for COVID-19. And you can see that if you look at the first week following the admission, 39 patients underwent critical care echocardiography. They all had vasopressor infusion. And you can see among the 40 patients without vasopressor infusion during the first week, you can see that we only perform echocardiography in 26 patients. The 14 other patients did not have any systematic echo. Overall, we perform 134 echo studies, including 70 by a TE route and by esophageal route, and 64 by a transthoracic route. Look at the results. The main result is that in the 26 patients without catecholamine, you can see that the systematic echo was normal in all patients. If you look at now the 39 patients who require some vasopressor infusion, you can see that the main echo pattern was vasoplegia in 38% of cases. You can see that in 28% of cases, patients had acute cardiac pulmonary, and in 25% of cases, left ventricular systolic dysfunction. And we only had a few patients with still hypovolemia. You have here overall the main echo parameters in the overall population and in the different patterns. So by definition, in the LV systolic dysfunction pattern, you can see that the ejection fraction was very low, in median 28%. In the ACP group, you can see that the right ventricle was bigger than the left in median, with a ratio between the end diastolic area of the right and the left ventricle of 1.1. You can see in still hypovolemic patient, we had significant respiratory variation of the supervena cava, so by definition using the T route. And here in patient with vasoplegia, the systolic function was preserved without right ventricular dilatation and without respiratory variation of the supervena cava. But you can see, interestingly, once again, as described previously in the big study published in Circulation Journal, you can see that we observed indeed a shortening of the pulmonary artery acceleration time in the overall population. So just reflecting once again the fact that all these patients had a certain degree of pulmonary hypertension. If you look at the evolution of the echo pattern within the first week, so during two periods, in gray, the first 2 days, and in black, after, so day three, day four, day five, day six, and day seven, following the admission, you can see interestingly that at the admission, so very early, the most frequent pattern was the LV systolic dysfunction pattern. And you can see that at the opposite, during the second period in a black, the main pattern was an acute core pulmonale, probably related in this kind of patient very frequently due to some complication about pulmonary thrombosis. You can see the vasoplasia was quite constant between the two periods. So look at some illustration now. You have TEE, this is the long axis view of the left ventricle. You can see that the LV systolic function was severely impaired. And here, this is the short axis view by a transgastric approach. Look at no respiratory variation of the supravena cava. Here, this is the patient still hypovolemic. You can see that the LV is hyperkinetic with a small cavity and some degree of end-systolic exclusion. And you can see it was associated with significant respiratory variation of the supravena cava. Here, this is a vasoplegic patient. The LV systolic function was preserved without any respiratory variation of the supravena cava, no RV dilatation. Look at here, this patient with ACP. The right ventricle is bigger than the left ventricle. You can see on the short axis a paradoxical septal motion, and it was related to some thrombus, some clot into the pulmonary circulation, here into the right pulmonary artery, and here just at the bifurcation of the lobar arteries. Another example here, the right ventricle is bigger than the left. Look at how the patient is tachycardic. You can see once again a paradoxical septal motion on the transgastric approach. And now you observe some clot on the central venous catheter, which is just there into the right atrium. So probably this patient had some material also into the pulmonary circulation. So that's the main echo patterns. So of course, we have only a small series, so it remains to be confirmed. For instance, here in this international study that we want to conduct with this group of people coming from the echo group of the cardiodynamics section of the European Society of Intensive Care Medicine. And I hope that in the future, we will have bigger data just to describe and to explain the different cardiac injury into the COVID-19 patients. I thank you for your attention.